everybody. Welcome back. My name is Larry Herb, Xbox Live's Major Nelson. I'm here with you in your ears or in your speakers, in your car, wherever you're listening to us. I'm here with Jeffrey. Hi, Jeff.
Hi.
Jeffrey.
I'm sorry to be in your ear canals.
Well, we all are. It's that's the beautiful thing of podcasting. Laura couldn't join us this week. She had a little last-minute emergency, and we weren't going to cancel the show because I'm really excited, Jeff. You know I'm a big fan of our next guest. Our in-studio guest, he was, I believe, I need to check Wikipedia, but I believe he was the longest-running editor of Thrasher magazine.
Not only that,
ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Chris Charlin. No, that's not true. Hi, Chris.
Hey, how's it going?
Is it true that you won X Games Seattle in 1994?
I won X Games Wallingford.
Awesome.
There weren't a lot of entries, but yeah.
But yes. You're here. But it's great to see you, Chris. Of course, you're in charge of our ID at Xbox Game. And we announced earlier, I think, but you know, depending upon when you listen to the show, but we announced recently that 500 games have been launched on the ID at Xbox program. Wow.
Yeah, it's awesome. And it's been super fun so far. And there's tons more coming, too.
Do you remember the first one?
Gee whiz, that's a great question, Jeff. I don't think I do.
It seems like it was just yesterday.
Yeah. I remember the first one.
Go ahead and tell us.
It was Strike Suit Zero.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. Yeah. That's right.
Space
I remember.
Shooter.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. A really fun space shooter. Yeah.
That's right. I remember that. Well done. And so that was the first one. And I know there's a whole bunch that came out. So which one did you guys look at and say, this is number 500?
Yeah, we really had to do that because, you know, when we were counting, we knew we were getting close to 500. And then we were saying things like, okay, well, are we just looking at Xbox One? Are we counting Windows 10?
Right.
We obviously help a lot of Windows 10 games ship as well. And then the big question was like, well, does an Xbox game preview game count?
Because right.
It's not technically 1.0,
right.
But you still have shipped something. And anyway, we took all these things into account. We had top men working on it.
Yep, top men.
PricewaterhouseCoopers.
Yes.
And we determined that City Skylines was number 500.
Yay. Which is now available
that's
on
right.
Xbox
yep.
One, of course. That's yep. Well, congratulations. I wanted to get you on because obviously that's a huge milestone. I mean, anytime any game that ships is unbelievable, but you work really closely with all these teams around the world.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we've had games ship now, I think, on maybe six continents.
Six.
We've had
which one's Miss Antarctica?
So we haven't had anybody ship from Antarctica. So
well, we do
sorry,
have
McMurdo Base.
We do have listeners. Apparently, I've been told we have listeners on the show from McMurdo Base. So if you're in McMurdo Base,
that would be awesome.
Contact Chris Charles so we can get you an ID.
make
any game. Survival yeah. on McMurdo Base. Or what's? Wait a minute.
The
remember,
thing.
Remember what happened? That, what was it like back in the '60s where somebody was? I think it was down there where he had to operate on himself. Do you remember that story?
Oh yeah. Yeah.
This like doctor. There was no one there, and he had to operate himself. I know it's mortifying.
I
as
didn't even
Jeff.
Want to see 128 hours.
Yeah.
So. Anyway, so congratulations. This is really great. Let's talk about some of the milestones in the program and frankly where you're going from here.
Yeah, I mean, so we launched the program more than 3 years ago before Xbox One launched. We announced it, I think, 2013 at Gamescom.
Yeah.
We had incredible developer response. We still have amazing developer response. We still have new developers joining the program every day, and you know, we just worked as hard as we could to make sure that, like, it is as easy as possible for a developer to get their game out on Xbox One and
right.
on Windows 10. And, you know, it's just a testament to the support of Xbox fans. It just, you know, how well the program is done because they've generated, you know, hundreds of millions of dollars in sales for
right.
ID at Xbox developers.
Right.
Millions and millions of copies of games have been sold, and it's been a really successful program so far. And we're not slowing down.
And I want to point out, it's obviously you're in charge of the program, but you've got a whole team behind you.
There's a huge team here at Microsoft who work on it. And the other thing that's been probably the most amazing thing is from the day one of the program is, you know, we started with a really small little team, and we would go to these different parts of Microsoft, and we were asking for big changes in how our back-end systems work to accommodate independent developers, and we were not sure what reception we were going to get, honestly. We knew it was the right thing to do, and we hoped other people did, and we would go into these meetings with, like, you know, 10 people you've never met before, some part of Microsoft you didn't even really knew existed, but you kind of had to get through to ship a game, and you're a little bit intimidated.
Sure.
And you've got, like, your 8-slide PowerPoint presentation, and we'd go in there, and like the first thing that would happen is they'd be like, oh, you're the indie guys, how can we help? And then the second thing would be like, have you seen this game? Have you seen that game?
Oh, really?
And so the support from
really
inside
engaged.
Microsoft
yeah.
was just like ridiculous. Yeah, and then since then we've built the team up bigger, and you know, continue to encounter the same level of awesome support from inside Microsoft. We have an unbelievable team of really, really passionate folks who are just super invested in developer success.
Tell me a little bit about you know, this show is a little bit abnormal because we're celebrating the 500th of ID at Xbox. So we may go over some of the stuff we're playing. Right, Jeff?
I think we should do that, especially since there's some... I was making sure to play a bunch of ID at Xbox.
Do you want to do that right now, and then we can kind of talk about... Because I have a ton of questions, both from Twitter as well personally, that I want to talk to Chris about the ID at Xbox program.
Well, I'm assuming you've been playing Voodoo Vince. Yes, that's not, not a video podcast.
Yeah, you need to say yes. He's nodding his head.
Well, one of the things I've really been enjoying, and I find myself spending more time with a lot of ID games recently, because a lot of them have adopted the Xbox Play Anywhere program. Voodoo Vince being one of them. So during a conference call today...
You were not.
Oh, come on. That's like my MO. I beat Dark Souls on a conference call.
That's awesome.
But Voodoo Vince, I've really gotten into... I love that sort of exploratory, you know, 90s feeling game. I guess it came out probably in the first couple years of the 2000s. But like... Ukulele is another one, which I need to jump into. But definitely getting into Voodoo Vince, another game, Enter the Gungeon I was playing. These are just like in the past week on my PC while I've been traveling. Spheroids, I had a pretty good time with. And Everspace, which is still in game preview. I'm waiting for, can't wait till they give achievements. But they've added a lot to that game.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And being able to play that and jump back and forth. Oh, and Snake Pass was another one, which was pretty cool.
Snake Pass is awesome.
Yeah, we've talked about it a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, it was like, all of a sudden, like, this actually how a snake feels, I guess.
Yeah, I mean, right? you're playing it and you're like, wait, what do I got to, you know, waggle the stick to make... Oh, yeah,
like that feels right. It's like a snake.
And yeah, that game is really fun.
I played that and then I watched Planet Earth 2, like the part where... Oh, I have a copy here, by the way.
Do you have my copy?
Yeah, it's right here.
My disc, my 4K version.
Yes, because I wanted to test out I got a 4K TV and that is the thing you test it out with. But that scene where the... racer snakes are going after, and I was like, I wish I was that good in Snake Pass.
Yeah,
you know, to catch those iguanas.
No spoilers.
Sorry.
Voodoo Vince. So anyway, Voodoo Vince. Chris, we're just going to talk about what we're playing, and then we're going to get back to this great 500 milestone. I haven't played City Skylines yet. I'm sure you have, and it's a lot of fun.
You know, I haven't played it on Xbox yet.
Oh,
I've played it a ton on PC, but I usually try and wait till a game's commercially available before I play it.
Yeah, that's I'm the same way, because you find out you kind of, I don't know, you just want to experience it the way that our fans and Xbox people, you know, everyone else experiences it.
And I want to be able to talk about it on Twitter, and I want to be part of the, you know what I mean? Like, I want to play it day one, but I want to play it when it's available so I can talk about it. And,
yeah.
Once in a while, I'll break that rule, like Inside.
Yeah.
I played before. But.
Yeah. So that's important to point out, is that Inside was also an ID game.
Yeah, absolutely.
And it's interesting, because you have had the scope of teams, you know, anywhere from a single to double, two or three people, up to much, much larger teams that have worked around the world dispersed, right?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. We have everything from, you know, one man or one woman teams all the way up to, you know, 200 person studios coming through ID.
Yeah.
And it's kind of you know, when we designed the program, instead of kind of focusing on, you know, what was an indie game in 2013, we kind of looked and said, like, how can we, you know, make this future proof a little bit. And so that was what a lot of the back end work was. And so,
from a technology standpoint,
exactly. Yeah. And so we've ended up enabling, you know, a lot of different game types. My favorite kind of trivia fact is that the MLB is technically an independent developer, because RBI Baseball is an ID at Xbox game.
Right. So, even though it's licensed,
right.
It's got licensed goods.
It's made by the MLB.
Right.
And so they're an indie developer.
Right.
Yeah, it doesn't.
Oh, wow, wait a minute. My head just exploded. Yeah. Right. Yeah. MLB's okay.
Yeah. It doesn't necessarily, it's not like the days of every game being like sprite based, 8-bit, four people making the game. Yeah. I mean, those games still exist. And
absolutely.
Are pretty
great. There's some great ones.
But yeah, there's some like very visually impressive games out there.
Yeah, exactly.
Sort of defining, like, the definition of indie has changed significantly.
Well, yeah, really. How do you look at that? You know, because we get that asked all the time. How is an indie game versus a AAA title? I mean, are those really the two categories?
Yeah, you know, we don't. You know,
you
we actually, you know, I come from the punk rock era, and I spent like most of my 20s arguing about what was punk rock and what wasn't punk rock. And
did you come to a solution?
No.
Okay.
And so with
time well spent.
Yeah, absolutely. with independent games, we decided early on we weren't going to worry about that. You know, if a developer comes to us and says, "Hey, I'm an independent developer and I want to ship a game through ID at Xbox," we're like, "Sounds great," and you can be, you know, one person.
And then you look at their email address and it says so-and-so at EA.com.
right? EA has another path onto the console. But, you know, if it's Major League Baseball or it's, you know, one person in South Africa, like, right, we're excited to see their games.
Yeah. Yeah, I was talking with some of the people from your team when I was in Australia, and they told me about some of the games you guys are working on and some that aren't out yet. But it's just the richness of the tapestry and that you have to select from is just, it's unbelievable.
It is amazing. And when we first started the program, you know, one of our big goals was we wanted to make sure when Xbox players turn on their Xbox One, they have access to this huge, diverse array of content. And if you had asked me to say what that meant in 2013, I would have had an answer. And I would say by 2014, I was already completely blown away. Right. And you look today at the breadth of content.
Over 500 titles.
Over 500 titles. And just the diversity of, you know, things, you know, from Smite to Inside to Three Force Home to, you know, Thimbleweed Park, Her Majesty's Spiffing. Like, so much variety in the games that are coming from independent developers. There's really something for everyone.
What has changed since you started the program in terms of a technology or the approach or the types of games you're seeing? Talk to me a little bit about the cycles, you know.
What we see is we've seen what we're seeing now on Xbox One, which I think is really cool, is we're seeing sophomore efforts and junior efforts. Mm-hmm. So developers who have shipped one game on Xbox or two games on Xbox,
they cut their teeth.
Yeah, and now they're working on new things and they're pushing the boundaries of the hardware. And, you know, obviously Project Scorpio is going to, you know, change that even more. But the really cool thing I think that we're seeing is we're seeing developers at all stages of their journey. So we're seeing, you know, we're still getting lots and lots of, you know, console debuts coming onto Xbox One from developers in the ID at Xbox at the same time as we're seeing, you know, these veteran studios. And then the one really fun thing is we're seeing groups of veterans like the guys at System Era who made Astroneer, who have, you know, incredible resumes, come together with some new blood and then just make a new studio, make a new game that's informed by not only, you know, the kind of passion that the new guys are bringing, but also the veteran stuff that the veterans have seen. And you end up with a debut effort in Astroneer that actually is a, you know, stunning game.
I want to point out also the fact that this is, you know, 500 more titles. These are purely digital titles.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, this is the days of shipping on a disc while still exists for some part of the audience. These are all digital titles. That's amazing.
Yeah, it's super cool.
Yes, Jeffrey, you had something to add.
No, I was just wondering if out there are students who are putting together games and there's a lot of like pretty well-developed programs these days and that are thinking like, how do I get it off the ground? How could I get onto Xbox? What is that first step for them?
Yeah, so, I mean, first of all, you can just come to xbox.com/ID and apply. But the other thing that we announced at GDC that I think is really exciting is the Xbox Live Creators Program.
Now, what is that?
So it's a really cool program. So basically, you are home. You have a retail Xbox One.
Like you bought at Best Buy or GameStop or anywhere else, right?
You download, I think it's called the Dev Mode app.
.exe.
Yeah. There's a free app. Sorry, I just spaced on the name of it. Dev Mode Activation, I think.
Yep.
And it's a free app that's on the Xbox One app store that turns your Xbox into a dev kit. And then you can download free version of Visual Studio, and you can deploy a game from Visual Studio on your PC, a UWP game, to your Xbox One, and it runs in the, you know, the your PC sees the Xbox as another PC because Xbox One runs Windows 10, and you can just deploy a game to your Xbox and immediately start playing it with your controller on your television.
Right.
And so that was really cool. We announced that actually last year in 2016 at GDC.
Right.
And so in 2017, we announced Xbox Live Creators Program. So now, in addition to doing all that for playing and testing, you can go get, without signing any NDAs, without, you know, signing any contracts, you can just go download Xbox Live.
Yeah.
Implement Xbox Live into your game, most of the features, all the social features like identity and presence and leaderboards, and then put that into your game and ship it on Windows 10 and on Xbox One.
So this is the, I guess, as what programmers call APIs, right?
Yeah.
These are your APIs that allow you to call into Xbox Live, which is obviously a massive service with millions and millions of people. And easily implement that in your game.
Yeah, absolutely.
Link into that in the show notes if that sounds like something you want to. It's like a 4-step process.
Yeah, it's really straightforward. And those games, they don't have everything that a game that comes through the ID program or from a publisher like Electronic Arts has. They don't have access to achievements and gamer score.
We want to keep those as pure as we can.
That's right. Yeah. And they don't have access to the multiplayer features. So we have those gated. But if there's nothing stopping a game, like a student game or something like that, from starting as a game that's in the creators program, and then at any point, either it's during development or even after they launch, like talking to the folks at ID and then just becoming an ID at Xbox game and getting access to gamer score and achievement.
So you can go from the kind of the kiddie pool to the big pool to the Olympic pool.
Yeah, that's right. But I wouldn't say it's exactly a kiddie pool. Because I think we'll see we'll definitely see really cool games from students and experimenters and hobbyists and makers.
So let's call it a sandbox.
Right. But I think we'll see pros too.
Yeah.
Who want to get a game out really quickly, do a quick game, see what the response is, and then decide if they want to take it to ID. But I think what's really cool is two things. One is it makes sure that every Xbox can now be used for creation as well as playing. And then two, when you look at just the full spectrum for developers, whether you're coming through ID, whether you're going through a third party studio, or whether you just want to do it all yourself, completely unmanaged, like there's a place for you on the Xbox.
If you want to make a game. And regardless, as you said, if you're one person or 10 people, we have a solution for you.
Absolutely.
Right? At very, very low to almost no cost.
Yeah.
Right? You can use that console you already have at your house.
Yes, exactly. It's amazing.
Yeah. That's fun. Yes, Jeffrey.
I'm waiting to see what kind of game you're going to come up with.
Me?
Yeah. Major's Revenge.
I don't know what kind of game I would come up with. I've had many of idea over the time, and I know a great game when I see it, but it feels like I'm always surprised at the creativity that comes through the program. Like I say, we talked about Inside, which is one of those zowie moments when you get to the end. I don't want to have any spoilers. We all got to the end. Many of us did. But the creativity in this space is great. But it's also great to see, we had Thimbleweed Park, and I had Ron on a few weeks ago. And it's great to see, Ron, who's been in the games industry, longer than anybody in this room for the most part, shipping on that platform, right? And doing some really cool stuff.
And then you've got Cuphead.
I got to ask you, when's Cuphead coming out?
It's coming out in 2017.
Okay.
That's what the team has said, and so it's coming out this year. But, you think about that game, like when you start a program, you think, oh, we're going to get this kind of game, we're going to get that kind of game. Nobody thinks we're going to get a game that is 100% hand-animated in 1920s style paired with, Contra-style run-and-gun gameplay.
Right.
Unless you're the Moldenhauer brothers, you can't think that up. And then you see it, and it's just, every time I see it, and I've seen it a lot, it just blows me away every time. I cannot believe this is an interactive video game.
Right, right. And then of course, you talk about the story with Inside, which was very story-driven, and I don't want to say it was simple gameplay, but it was very approachable.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right?
I mean, that game was in development for a long time. It's not a long game, but one thing that they did, and they're, such great designers, was every second of that game, every place you were, they knew everything you might do there, and they basically had a custom animation for it.
Yeah.
And were ready to go. And it's just, it's unbelievable.
And it's also, I love, because Playdead, right?
Yeah.
They just recently won some DICE Awards, right?
Yeah, I think they won some DICE Awards, and they just won a BAFTA.
Yeah, the
BAFTA.
And it's funny, because they like to just let the game speak for themselves.
That's exactly right.
Right, and that's always admirable. Moving right along here, Jeffrey, you got some other stuff we want to go over?
I don't know. Do you want to hit news?
We might as well hit news. I mean, we're talking about games. If you have any, we had some questions from Twitter, Chris. So while we're reading some of the news headlines, if you can go out to Twitter and grab some of those, we'll answer those when we come back. Yeah, you're going to stay here with us, but we'll answer those in just a minute. Let's go through some of the headlines. We've got, even though Laura's not here, we're going to do Name the Game. I've asked Chris to pick up the mantle on that this week, so we're going to do that. But yeah, let's go through.
And you have to, is it going to be a punk rock game?
Maybe ID at Xbox game. We'll find out. So.
So one of the big changes, we've been listening to feedback, and for the system itself, for Xbox One, we released a number of fan-inspired feature updates to the community last month. More are coming. So,
yes.
There's quite a bit, but one of the big things is Arena. We've been talking about it. It's going to be coming now to Killer Instinct. So, when you hear about the world of esports, people immediately think pro gamers, people that, do this.
Call of Duty, Halo.
Exactly.
Right.
But people that play 14 hours a day, in arenas and things like that.
Yeah.
But really, esports can be as simple as, like, you know, the equivalent of, like, the work league or something like that.
I want a beer league.
Exactly,
esports.
A beer league. And now you're going to be able to set that up. So we have a lot of details, and I can link out to that, but
Please do.
Easier than ever to set up a Killer Instinct tournament. Smite is actually going to be supporting this as well.
World of Tanks.
World of Tanks, which was the first, and Halo Wars 2. So a lot coming there. A party overlay. Mm. So I don't know if you've tried out the achievements overlay. I'm an achievement hunter. And so when I'm trying to track an achievement where I'm like having to collect, I'm actually doing this with Voodoo Vince, where you need to get like 100 of the zombie sands, zombie dust bags or whatever. I actually got one this morning, where you can do a little bit of an overlay that keeps track as you go. If you haven't tried this, it's sort of like, I think Gears of War 2 was like the first game where as you were getting close, when you did your first active reload, it would let you know you're getting your progress towards the achievements getting closer. Well, similar thing with the party overlay. So you can see who's in your party and who's speaking at any given time, like the little speaker icon.
Really helpful for Destiny raids. And you can move it around to any one of eight quadrants on the screen. Sectors on the screen.
Yes. So and a number of other features, but one that I know, Larry, you're definitely going to want to take advantage of, and that is captive portal support.
Yes.
So if you take that word by itself, captive portal support, what does that mean?
That's engineering speak, Jeffrey.
Yes, it is.
But why don't you tell us what it really means?
In layman speak, you can use your Xbox One in a hotel.
Yeah.
So all of these, I've traveled with my Xbox One a number of times, and I have a travel router for different places on Wi-Fi where you have to, and hotels are the most common example of this, where you have to like click through on a website in order to like turn
accept
it on.
Accept the terms of agreement, high speed, low speed, what's your room number, etc.
Yeah, you will be able to do that directly through the Xbox One. That's something that we are working on, and a number of other features that we're hearing from the community. So I know that's one of the ones I'm excited about. A number of things involving clubs, involving Beam and Twitch broadcasts, a number of things. We'll link to that. And normally I'll pick out a couple of games to highlight. And then I was like, oh, in honor of Xbox, of ID at Xbox, in honor of you being here, I'll call out one or two. But this is a great week for ID, like an insane week. So we talked about Voodoo Vince. Again, this is an XPA game. This was a game that I first knew about because Phil Spencer is a big fan of Voodoo Vince.
Well, what am I, chopped liver?
Well, is there a Major Nelson Easter egg in the game?
There is. I can't confirm or deny.
Well, look, we'll always have Kinect Sports.
Yes, that's right. Thank you.
Where you didn't finish first.
Thank you, Craig Duncan.
Yes, exactly. So it's an excellent game from that era of the OG Xbox era of exploratory third person character based
platformers
and adventure. And I'm definitely having a lot of fun with that New Orleans theme. Flint Hook. This is a game a lot of people are talking about. Hearing it, there's like a Bionic Commando sort of vibe to it. What can you tell me?
It is amazing. So super fun, basically like, I guess you could describe it as an action platformer, but you've got this cool hook, grappling hook mechanic. And the thing about the game that is just really cool is it's super fluid. And they've done done a lot of work with the controller. So you just, from your thumbs to the screen, it's just like, there's no barrier. And so the game itself just flows really, really beautifully. They have a bunch of GIFs online that you can see it, and it's just unbelievable.
So that's Flint Hook.
Two
really beautiful games that came out this week. Help me if I'm pronouncing this right. Shyness, The Lightning Kingdom. This is like an RPG, and that looks really, has a very cool cel-shaded look that kind of reminds me of like Dragon Quest VIII, which is one of my favorite games of all time. This has a really cool look to it. And something I like about it, based on what I heard, is it's not a 100-hour RPG.
Right.
It's nice when you can actually fit one into your schedule. And another game that just looks fantastic is Wonder Boy, The Dragon's Trap. And we have a great article on Xbox Wire that was written by one of the devs from Lizard Cube. And we have actually a couple of animation GIFs as well built into that. So definitely worth checking out. And then,
what are these animated GIFs?
These animated GIFs?
GIF.
GIF. I said it right?
Obama said it was GIF, so.
So he's got more authority than I do. Another game with a very interesting visual style in the complete opposite direction is Late Shift.
Yeah.
So full motion video is back.
It is?
From our friends at Wales Interactive. They put together a full motion video game, and they've done some really neat stuff with it. First of all, I think the cinematography is great. You look at still images, or you look at it when it's moving, and like, they did a really nice job. And it's an FMV game, like a classic FMV game, and you basically make these, actually it's a little different than classic FMV games, so it's not like Night Trap or Sewer Shark.
Sega CD owner right here.
Yep, yes. Yep. It's more like a choose your own adventure game. So there's not a lot of repeating video. It's really just like you get to a branching choice and you have like a very short amount of time to
Dragon's
make a choice.
Dragon's Lair style, yeah.
And you've got to sort of decide like, hey, am I going to, how am I going to choose how to progress the story?
Right.
And it really does have some meaningful branches. I think there's 7 different endings. And so there's a lot of different things that can happen. And I was really surprised by the production values. And
let's check that
really
out.
Neat one.
Yeah, so there's a bit of a renaissance there, like Her Story last year, and that won some awards as well.
Yeah, and Wales Interactive also did The Bunker, which is another more traditional FMV game that was super disturbing, so...
Way to sell it.
Yeah.
But you're right, you're right.
Sometimes you want that out of
it. Yeah, you're right.
A couple other non-ID titles, Guardians of the Galaxy, Telltale Series Episode 1 is out. Kind of excited for this one, the Disney Afternoon Collection. As someone who used to come home from school and play DuckTales every single day.
Don't stop it. Why are you making me feel old?
What? I was a little too old to be playing DuckTales, but I could beat it in one go. And this one's maybe right up your alley, Larry. Professional Farmer 2017.
You know, I've heard about that. And you know, I love my farming simulators.
I know you do. And I love how they still use that sort of like that italicized font that goes back all the way to like Flight Simulator.
Flight Sim, yeah.
Exactly. It lets you know who this audience is for, which is you, Larry.
A lot of news out this week. Head over to majornelson.com or news.xbox.com, whichever is your fancy, and we'll make sure we show you what's going on. There's just so much, Jeff.
There is. There's one last thing. Star Wars Battlefront 2.
Yeah. Was down in Orlando for that.
Yeah.
Lovely. Cool. You're old stomping grounds.
It is. I came for the Magic Kingdom and I stayed for the humidity.
Yes, you did.
Yes.
Yes, you did. It was
for 9 years.
It was humid down there, but yeah, it was a lot of fun to go down there. So we've got a video up on this week on Xbox. Mm-hmm. In fact, I dressed as a Jedi. Have you seen it yet?
No, I haven't seen this.
You've got to see this one. It's great. The team did a great job. So you'll watch the latest episode of this week on Xbox.
I will do that.
It's on my Twitter. Okay.
Follow now at Major Nelson.
I don't care. Whatever. You know how to find me.
And Janina Gavincard, you know her? She's going to be playing Eden Urso Versio.
Apparently, I've worked with her before.
You have? Yeah. She's a huge gamer, and we've worked with her in a number of different ways.
I remember she's a delightful young lady.
She was in True Blood, and you've seen her.
Yeah.
You'll know her.
We worked together. Like, we did an E3 together.
Yeah.
What?
How come you're not in this game either?
This is the burning question. Maybe I'm in Voodoo Vince as a
right, I'm gonna have to go back and get all the collectibles to unlock them.
Look for a microphone. Yeah. So anyway, so those are the news. You know how to find it. We said we're gonna take some questions from Twitter. You had a couple out here. Do you mind? I've got a couple here if you want to go over them.
Yeah. Do you want to start or do you want me to start?
I got one up here right away from Megan. Savannah wants to know. I'm supposed to ask you about your zine, Incredibly Strange Games. What is that?
So I do a fanzine. Yeah. I've done fanzines ever since I was like 6 years old.
Right.
And so I do a fanzine still about strange video games, and it's printed. And
also, which is even stranger.
Yeah, yeah. No, I miss like using Quark Express or InDesign and stuff.
Wow.
And there is like a blog for it too. But I'm linking to that.
Oh, okay. IncrediblyStrangeGames.com.
That's correct. Yes. But to get the real thing, you've got to see me at a show, and I usually have some. Although recently in Seattle, we've done a couple live nights at a bar that is smaller than this studio.
Really?
And so we'll have a couple different people come and bring and show off weird games. And then we'll make like a little mini zine for that show. So.
Wow.
Is it the Grizzled Wizard or something?
No, I wish. It's Grizzled Wizard is awesome, but it's at the Fuse Box, which is up by the zoo.
Oh, I'll have to go there.
That's
up near your house.
Let me know.
That's
up near your house.
Yeah, that's good.
Okay, good. Fun. So Megan wanna know about that. Are you ever too old to skate? You're a skateboarder.
I am a skateboarder. No, you're absolutely never too old to skate.
Yeah, I completely agree. And then finally, tater tots or nachos, and there only better be one answer.
You know, I really feel like Seattle doesn't have a lot of native foods, but Seattle does tater tots better than any place in the whole country.
You don't have to choose between tater tots and nachos. You go down to Ballard, and there's a counter in a wall. I don't know what it's connected to, but you go up there and you get the tachos.
Yeah, well, you know, Damon's, which is the sports bar closest to where we're sitting right now here in Redmond, has some of the best tachos on the east side. So.
Seattle owns the tachos.
I have no room in my diet for tater tots.
Yeah, maybe after E3.
No, I never. I don't like them spicy.
Live a little.
I don't. Right? They don't interest me. It's. I don't know.
Tater
whatever.
Tater tots like are amazing. Seattle's national food. Yeah, like, we don't have a lot to offer culinary wise here. But
I disagree. We've got tots. I disagree. As a gateway to Asia, you certainly do.
Oh yeah, you mean like good food? I'm talking like bar food.
Oh, fair point. Fair point. All right. So yeah, do you have any of the Twitter response you want to?
One question that came up a lot was just about what's going on with the game Ashen.
Yeah.
Which was with us at E3 a couple years ago. Right. And
can you remind people what the game's about?
Yeah, so it is a really cool, low-poly game that we showed a cool teaser trailer with some, you know, pretty violent stuff happening.
Yeah.
And so I'm not going to say more than that because I don't want to give away more than what they gave away.
Right.
But the team's still hard at work. And, you know, this is a case where, you know, I saw some, you know, video of latest builder recently, but it's up to the team when they want to announce what's going on. And so we, you know, as excited as we are for the game, like we can't say much more than.
Yeah, that's their project to own.
That's exactly right.
They own the messaging on it. So we don't want to take away any thunder from them. So stay tuned. What else you got over there for questions?
Another question was about, I think we already hit, but it was just about, hey, I'm my son's 14. He wants to get into game development. What should he do? Xbox Live Creators Program.
Like, right there.
Turn that Xbox into a dev kit and get going.
Yeah. Wouldn't it be awesome if, you know, if your mom or your dad or your family bought you an Xbox and then you came down one day and said, I made a game. How? I turned my Xbox into a dev kit.
And now I'm moving out.
Yeah, exactly.
Get my own place.
See you later, gang. Well, that's cool. Yeah. So they can find you on Twitter. Where do they follow? At IOCat.
IOCat. Yeah.
IOCat. Was there,
all these things are linked.
Do you want me to, can you explain the story behind that Twitter handle?
No, it's really old from the Apple II days. Everybody needed a handle.
I remember the Apple II days.
What was your first handle? Was it Major Nelson?
That's a great question. No, it wasn't. So that's a good question because there was, before there were computers and I lived in the time there was when I was a little boy, my dad, I had a CB radio.
Nice.
I had a CB radio license. So I had that. So my red handle, my dad gave it to me. Was Red Cap. That was it. So I don't know why, but that was what he gave me. So that lived and died right there. So anyway, that's the way to bring a broadcast to an end.
Oh no, we can't. You've got other stories.
Oh, I have many stories.
I want to know this Diet Dr. Pepper story.
Oh, the Diet Dr. Pepper story. What happened was, so Jeff came into the studio before we were recording. And he showed me the Diet Dr. Pepper and I got very excited. I'm a Diet Dr. Pepper fan. I should not drink it, but I do. So I have very few vices, Chris. When I joined the company in 2001, I was like, you know, we had free beverages at Microsoft. And I was like, oh, this is a cool big deal. And they didn't have Diet Dr. Pepper. So I started, this is before I was anybody, I started writing an email to the people that, whoever this email address was that was behind stock in the things. I'm like, hey, can we get Diet Dr. Pepper? And like every 2 months, I'd send the same letter. 2 months later, or I'm sorry, 2 years later, it finally appeared in the coolers and I'm taking credit for
it. Nice.
So I was really excited. Well, about 6 or 8 months ago, Jeff was with me. We noticed the Diet Dr. Pepper was no longer there.
Oh yeah, we got coconut water.
Right.
something had to go.
So I was like, wait a minute. And I was like, okay, maybe it's a bad week. Maybe they didn't restock. And I went to like 6 different coolers on campus looking for them. So I started my letter writing campaign again. And I said, hey, what happened? So long story short is the Diet Dr. Pepper.
I am drinking one right now, and it really does taste more like regular Dr. Pepper.
Yeah, so it's anyway, so I'm very excited that I was.
That's
so
awesome.
So that's, I'm taking credit for it being implemented, going away, and returning, it's triumphant return.
Larry, that's a great ripping yarn, but let's talk about the other thing that you're supposed to tell me about that I've been waiting to hear about.
Which one?
The thing that happened in Orlando.
So Chris, let me tell you what happened. Laura's going to be here to tell us. So I go to Orlando for the Star Wars celebration, which is amazing, and it's always so fun to be in Florida. So flat, Jeffrey.
There's no topography.
It's just like, anyway, well, you're in trouble when apparently the tallest mountain in Central Florida.
Oh, it is. It's a landfill.
It's Space Mountain.
Oh, I was in South Florida. My sister lives smelling distance from the Sample Road dump. which is
Mar-a-del-Trashmar.
Stepping into that one, Larry. At a height of like 400 feet is the highest point in South Florida.
Anyway, so I go to this hotel, and I will not give out the name to protect the innocent. But I get to this hotel, Chris, after flying all day, and we've all done this, you know, business trips, and I'm exhausted, and I just want to get to the room. And so I slide my card into the door. The door opens, and I open the door, and on the little desk, it's your basic hotel room, you know, with the bathroom, and then you walk through in the bedroom. And I see there's like this bottle of champagne and like flowers, and there's some food. I'm like, this is cool. This is all happening so quickly, but it's in slow-mo. Like, nobody knew I was here. Why do I have this? And as I step 3 foot, 4 foot, 5 foot in the room, I realize there is a couple without any clothes on in the bed. Oh my goodness. Apparently I barged in on their party. So they let out a gasp. I let out a gasp, and I said, oh, excuse me. And I looked at the gentleman, I said, I think you have things covered here. And I left.
Did you really?
I can think pretty quickly sometimes. And it was rather embarrassing. So I went down to the manager and I said, let me pull you aside here. Just FYI, this is, and he was mortified. And they put me in a different room, but I'd never had that happen, Jeffrey.
Yeah, I hope the new room had the champagne and the food as well.
I do not recall seeing that. That was a little disappointing.
I feel like a fruit basket might have been good
compensation. Bare minimum.
You think? Yeah. It was one of those moments where so whoever that young couple is that I interrupted, well done, and I'm sorry to bother you.
Keeping the magic alive.
Exactly. So, that was a... Thank you for. I wanted to tell that when Laura was here, because I kind of started telling you the story and you made me stop.
Yeah, because I wanted to.
Well, I texted you.
Yes,
I texted you and I said you're not going to believe this.
Yeah, the funny thing is, I totally believe that.
It is this. Yeah. The weirdest stuff happens to me when I'm on the road.
Yes, it does.
And then we were getting in to go see Mark Hamill. I didn't tell you this story.
No,
we're going in to see. They did the premiere of The Last Jedi, the trailer, and we were running late. It was me and somebody from the team, and this woman. This woman, the security woman and the security guy are standing. I said, hey, we need to get in to see it. And she looked at me, said, we can't let you in. It's over capacity. And there was this dead silence. And she looked at me. She said, you're the Xbox guy. Let's go. And she brought me in the back and we were standing on the side of the stage. It was nice. Really the special moment. So anyway, that's awesome.
Did you get to meet Mark?
I did not because they were, I didn't want to interrupt them. Right. They were having their moment.
Yeah, I guess so.
But it was fun. Orlando. Yay.
It's America's number one travel destination. Probably.
It is. Am I going back there? No, I'm not. I'm sorry. Apparently, I'm not going back anytime soon. But hopefully, you and I need to go back.
We've never gone together. We need to go to the Millennium Mall.
We need to go to the Millennium Mall.
I used to know the community manager at that Microsoft store there.
We need to go to Universal Studios if I'm allowed back on property.
Yeah, that'd be fun. Harry Potter Land.
I heard the Harry Potter Land at Universal in Florida was like.
Oh, it's pretty, it's crazy. Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Everybody says that.
It's very cool.
I can't wait till Star Wars Land opens up down at Disney World.
Mm-hmm.
Well, anyway, I'm sorry. We're doing too much theme park talk. That's another podcast that Jeff hosts.
Central Florida.
Inside theme parks.
Inside Central Florida.
So yeah. So anyway, hey, we've got Name the Game, which is we do every week. Laura couldn't join us, but I spoke to her and I said, hey, look, Chris Charles is coming on the show. Do you think he could do it? Because, I mean, he's the games guy. I mean, he does a zine. So she said yes. So anyway, we're going to play Name the Game. We're going to play the last week's clip right now. And Chris, you're going to come back and tell us who the winner is. How's that sound?
Sounds good. So, big congratulations to Hannah from Brighton, UK, gamertag Hannah Lou, who correctly identified Thimbleweed Park.
Yes.
And your prize, of course, is a copy of Thimbleweed Park.
But you came with your pockets stuffed.
That's right. That's not all.
That's not all.
In addition to Thimbleweed Park, which is a fantastic game, you will also get Flint Hook, new ID at Xbox.
We talked about that.
We already talked about.
Yep.
Late Shift.
Yep.
It's like
which
we
also
this
already
out.
Talked
right.
about. Super cool new ID at Xbox title.
Yep.
Voodoo Vince.
Which we also talked about.
Amazing. Which may or may not have a major Nelson Easter egg in it?
Cannot confirm or deny that at this time.
City Skylines.
Yes. Yeah. Which was the 500th ID at Xbox
game. 500th ID at Xbox game. Ding, ding, ding,
ding. Audio confetti, audio confetti, audio Woo-hoo. Confetti.
We'll add that in post.
Marvel's Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
From our friends at Telltale.
Wow. So that is a great collection of games. Thank you, Chris.
Pretty awesome.
Thank you, Chris, for all of those. First of all, congratulations, Hannah, for all the great, for identifying this. Now, you're probably listening right now saying, oh, come on. How do I get in on the free games, Chris Charla? Well, it's easy. All you need to do is we're going to play an audio clip right now, which is from an Xbox game. It could be any one of the types of games we talked about, but you play it on the Xbox. And you guess what that is, send us an email, major@xbox.com or lollipop@xbox.com. Tell us where you're from, and we'll put all the correct winners into a pile and randomly pull one. How's that sound, Chris?
I think that sounds awesome.
All right, you ready to play the clip from this week?
Yeah, absolutely.
So if you think you know what that is, just send me an email. Like I said earlier, major@xbox.com. You can CC Laura Lollipop at xbox.com. Good luck to everybody. Well, you could win cool games just like the ones Chris went over, right?
Absolutely.
Right. Well, how are things going? You getting ready for E3?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. You got. I mean, we're not going to talk too much about it because we can't. But it's always a busy time of the year for those ID games. They must get excited when you call them and say, "Hey, you want to be on the stage?" Right?
Yeah. Who doesn't? I mean, somebody. Right. You know. It's the big show, right?
Right, it is the big show.
It is the biggest stage in video games, and so to the extent we've been able to showcase some cool ID games there, it's been super awesome.
Or when we have them playable on the show floor, so absolutely. any of the events we're doing, it's always good to see that. And you guys are maybe I don't want to push it on you, but usually towards like around PAX Prime, we do a little ID game event here.
Yeah.
Are we going to do that again this year?
Yeah, absolutely. Okay. I think it is already booked.
Oh, is it?
Nice. Yeah, I'm pretty sure.
They haven't given us the dates, but that's just if everyone remembers, for the past couple of years, you and your team put together, you round up these amazing developers, you bring them on to the Microsoft campus here, and then we just throw open the doors and say, hey, if you're in the area, come on down.
Yeah, we have a big open house at Building 92.
Yeah.
And invite everybody in to play a bunch of ID games. And last year, I think we had 50 games, and we had Halo Wars, and the year before, we had, I think, Big Halo, and you know, and so
Big
Halo,
is that what we call it? Big Halo, Big Halo, Baby Halo.
But yeah, it's really fun. We throw open the doors for a few
hundreds
hours.
Hundreds of people show up. Yeah,
yeah. I think last
year
we had
many,
like,
many hundreds. Actually.
Yeah, tons.
Yeah, it was. It's a lot of fun because it's great to walk around and see. I mean, always whenever any of the events you do, you see the developers who. Many for the first time are showing off their games to people that have never seen it before.
Yeah.
So they're looking through it with really fresh eyes.
Yeah, and as a developer, and we talk to developers all the time, what's working for you, what's not working for you, and those kind of events they love, because, you know, it's not just about getting to see people. Most of these games that we show at these kind of events are not done yet.
Yeah.
And so they get to see people play their game before it's finished, so they get to see, like, oh, they're enjoying this part, they're not enjoying this.
Oh, they're having a hard time,
you know,
right.
And so it's great feedback, but I think to me, the thing that I always love, and if a developer hasn't shown, you know, publicly before, getting to see that happen for the first time is amazing, is that, you know, you've been working as your developer, you've been working on this game for months and months by yourself. You hope it's good, and you put it out there in the public. And when you see people start to play the game and they're smiling and they're laughing and they're getting their friends to play it,
yeah.
That energizes you as a developer so much.
Right.
And so, and for us, as you know, the guys who are, you know, on this program, getting to see the developers get energizes us. And it's just, you know, there's that moment for me anyway, right before, you know, one of those events opens its doors and you look around and there's like, you know, 50 new games and, you know, 50 studios, and it's just like super special to, like, you know, be there for that. And
yeah,
it's just really fun.
One of the games I played last year that I had a really good time with was Deformers. And that's coming out really soon, isn't it?
Yeah, Deformers should be out literally anytime now.
Yeah. So maybe even by
Deformers.
The time
what was it about?
So it's sort of like an arena battler of like these squishy animal balls. Yeah. Like, it's hard to, it looks really cool. And it's like, it's a game that I think you could play with like people of a variety of different skills, but there's definitely like some serious strategy to it.
Yeah. When you first play, it's like super fun, button mashy fun. So you play it at a show or something, you immediately get into it. But when you play it more and more, like, you know, obviously if you're skilled, you win. And so it's got like
kind of like life,
exactly. Like, easy to access, and then but it's actually got this deep skill thing too, which is really, really cool.
And it's made by Ready at Dawn, who I guess this would probably be the first game they've ever made to appear on Xbox, if I recall. They did the God of War games for PSP, Chains of Olympus, and whatever the other one was.
You worked on those.
I did.
Are you in those games?
I'm in the credits.
Yeah.
And then they did the Order 1886, and they're, you know, doing other stuff. So it's called. One of the marketing guys I knew because I used to work with them there, which was kind of cool. Anyway, keep an eye out for it. Yeah,
delightful. Yeah. So anyway, so we'll be doing that later this year. But yeah, you guys all have a lot going on. So what do you hope when you we're kind of wrap the show up here? But when you look forward, what do you hope to get out of the next 500 games on Xbox?
Man, if we got the same things that we got out of the last 500, I would be completely satisfied. But knowing what's coming, some of the games that are coming are just tremendous. And we try really hard on the program on ID. We never want to sit around and say like, oh yeah, we made it, like everything's cool.
No,
you know, like we're always just focused on like, hey, what can we do next? How can we shave 2 hours off a developer's journey onto Xbox? How can we make things a little bit easier? So we really focus on what's next and how we can fix things. But when I look at just the number of games that came out from that's awesome. When I look at just the number of games that have come out and just the diversity, it's just tremendous. And I think what you're going to see in the next 500, and we've got more than 1,000 games in development right now coming through the IDEA.
Wow.
Is just an incredible flowering of what independent developers can do. And what you thought an independent developer could do 5 years ago or 3 years ago or 6 months ago compared to what independent developers are going to be doing 6 months from now. Or
because you're looking 6, 12, 18, 24 months up the pipeline.
Yeah. And when we think about Project Scorpio, it is going to be ridiculous. And so it's a great time to be a player on Xbox. Right now.
I know that I don't want to put you in a position where you're, you know, representing every single idea at Xbox game, and I don't mean to do that, but since you work with them on a regular basis, what are some of the themes you see of, everyone talks about, mobile gaming is huge, and certainly it is huge for a certain audience, but how does that sit next to the ID game, or around it, behind it, above it, I don't know, right?
You know, it's been really interesting. We've seen games come to Xbox that actually started in mobile.
Right.
And, you know, and they do work to make sure it feels like an Xbox game and everything like that. And sometimes they do really, really well because it's, you know, it's about like, you know, is this game, you know, if we're thinking just about Xbox One, you know, putting Windows 10 aside for a minute, does this game feel good with my hands on a controller, looking at a TV in my living room?
Right.
And those kind of games can come from any place.
Right.
One thing that's been neat is we've seen some developers go to the mobile field, really, really great developers, and now they're coming back to console. They've learned stuff. But they want to be back in console, and it's amazing to see the games that those guys are producing.
I got to tell you, I just noticed this, Jeff. I don't know if you noticed this. You know, over the past month or so, I've been playing Zelda, Breath of the Wild.
You and I both.
Right, and I think you have as well, Chris? Yeah. And you have a Hetsu pen on.
No, it's not.
Is it?
It's Ooblets.
Oh, it looks like Hetsu. Oh, yeah. Okay. It looks like from here, it looks like Hetsu, the guy you give the seeds to.
No,
doesn't
no,
it?
Oh, is that the Korok seed name? I was like, I don't know what Hetsu is.
No. This is from a cool ID'd Xbox game called Ooblets. It's being developed by Glumberland, which is a 2-person studio.
Where are they?
They are in New Hampshire.
Oh, Jeff and I know New Hampshire very well.
We're going back.
So,
That's good. That's an Xbox Play Anywhere game as well, is it not?
Yeah, it's going to be Xbox Play
Anywhere. Tell us a little about Ooblets. When is that coming out?
I do not know.
Okay.
In the future.
In the future.
But it's super, super cool looking game. Really, really cute style. And it is basically a mashup of a farming game.
Mm-hmm. So Stardew Valley-like?
Yeah.
Okay.
Animal Crossing.
Okay.
In terms of interacting with all these kind of characters. And then the things that you're raising are these Ooblets.
Two people are doing this.
And that's right.
Right. Oh, my gosh.
And Rebecca and Ben. And
Are they a couple?
I think so, but I'm not sure.
Okay,
so
doesn't matter.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter.
And then there's a big Pokemon element in terms of these characters that you're raising and collecting.
Have you heard of that game, Jeffrey? Pokemon?
The Pokemons?
The Pokemons. I know
you. I may have had to... Look, I'm not bragging about my Pokedex being 227. I wouldn't do that on a podcast or
Jeffrey,
anything like that, but beat it.
Nobody likes a braggart, I believe, is what someone told me.
I may have said that to you one time. Bit me on the butt for that one.
Anywho, yeah, that's, I remember Ublis because I saw that when I came down to San Francisco for doing our event.
Yeah, at GDC.
Right, yeah, I remember that. I can't wait to see that. But yeah, I'd love to go back up to New Hampshire.
Yeah, New Hampshire's awesome.
I don't think we've ever had a game out of New Hampshire.
They may be. So we just shipped our first game from South Africa.
Okay.
And yeah, this may be our first game from.
Do you track? Do you have, like? Do you guys have a map? Like, you know, a big map with like push pins on it?
We actually, somebody on our team has gone into like Power BI, and we actually have a spinning globe that we have a GIF of a spinning globe that shows where every ID at Xbox developer.
Can you send it to me?
Yeah.
If you tweet it out, I'll retweet it.
Yeah.
I'd love to see
it.
Awesome. That'd be awesome.
And Antarctica, just
underrepresented.
Out.
Yeah,
come on, guys.
See, I know you're like you're obsessed with that because I remember a few years ago at PAX, you like stood up in the middle of the panel and you're like, does anyone on your 3DS, like, because you were trying to get like one last state, like Indiana or something like that, to get the street pass with?
Yeah, I needed Iowa.
I knew it was an I state.
Yeah.
Right.
Antarctica, come on. We need it. We need to hit that
awesome.
seventh continent.
We need. Have you ever had one from my home state of Connecticut?
I don't know if we have.
Oh, come on, Nutmeg State. I need you to represent.
It's the Nutmeg State?
Yes, it is. Yes,
so
it is.
So there's a state completely around kicking a soccer ball between someone else's legs?
That's sure. Very interesting. Okay, that's pleasant. That's really what you're doing here on the show?
That's what a nutmeg is.
No, I'm just, it is a spice.
That too.
Okay. Don't you have it on your
eggnog
your
once
eggnog.
A year?
Apparently that's
maybe not the best industry.
No, it's
the
certainly
thriving nutmeg industry.
Yes, it's good right along with
home of Big Nutmeg, Big in Hartford.
Big Nutmeg and Big Insurance. Anyway, so yeah, there's so you've got great. Anyway, man, I know I got to let you go because you've got some work to do.
Yeah.
So I really appreciate you coming by. You're always welcome, Chris Charler. Always welcome to come on the show at IOCat. You can follow him on Twitter. If they see you, they can get a zine from you, right?
That's right.
Yeah. I would like a zine.
And I have to warn you, if you're wearing a Cuphead shirt and you're walking around, I will stop you and start talking to you.
Okay.
That's I was just in LA and I saw somebody walking around with a Cuphead shirt and I was like...
Did he know who you were?
Actually, yeah, he kind of did. And so we just ended up talking about Cuphead and Xbox for a long time. Super cool dude.
That's great. Well, that's beautiful. I mean, isn't that great when you're traveling? Certainly when we're in Redmond in Seattle, we run into people that are Xbox fans all the time. But Jeff and I, and just like yourself, you travel the world and you run into people who... I ran into this when I was in Orlando. The guy at TSA, Jeff, I didn't tell you this, the TSA... No. The guy looked at, you know, I hand him my ID and my airline ticket, and he looks at me, Major Nelson, how's it going? I said, what's up? And so we started talking about what we were playing. You never know where people you run into.
And then you were randomly quote selected for,
you know, now that you mention it, I was.
Screening. Yeah.
I was.
Yeah.
They
got any game codes in those pockets?
I was checking into a tiny little, like, it was after Gamescom, and I was going up to meet my family in Scandinavia, and on the way I stayed in Hamburg for a night, and I was checking this tiny little, like, you know, whatever the cheapest hotel was I could find in Hamburg. Mm-hmm. I'm checking in, I'm all exhausted, and the guy just looks at me, and I was wearing a Cuphead shirt. He's like, Cuphead, when is it shipping?
That's awesome.
It was kind of amazing.
And yeah. You're kind of like exhausted. You're like, wait a minute, what? It's amazing how those moments just kind of snap into focus. And you're like, well, there's, it just shows you, to your point about the 500 games, how games of all sizes, shapes and sizes touch everybody around this globe.
Absolutely. It's amazing. It totally brings everybody together. Like, if you see somebody with a Cuphead shirt on,
yeah, Cuphead.
Yeah, yeah. You got something in common.
Jeffrey, do you have a Cuphead?
I don't.
Because I don't either. I don't either.
Yeah.
We may be able to fix that.
All right.
I want a Mugman shirt.
I actually prefer my Mugman shirt to my Cuphead
shirt. Wait, there's a Mugman shirt?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
He's got the big nose like me, and he's blue like me.
Like you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I will. Either way. Maybe you get Cuphead, Mugman from him, and Cuphead for me.
We can
there we go. That's a new... Twitter banner. Right,
I need there. To change. You know what else? You know, we talked earlier about some of the new features coming to Xbox, and one of them is custom gamer pictures.
I updated mine.
Yeah, I saw you updated yours. I updated. Mm-hmm. Did you update yours yet?
I have not yet.
Yeah, I mean, I need to update mine with Cuphead.
I still have my day one. You know, remember like on the 1 year anniversary, you got that day one gamer picture, and so like I really like that one. So.
I feel the same way. My original one was the Toast one, which
Angry Toast.
Which we call Angry Toast because he's like, "Rrr." So I finally swapped it out and I did a great picture of the Scorpio engine, you know, the chip.
Oh, nice.
And then I now have one for Voodoo. So yeah, I'll change it out every now and then. But that feature will be coming to everybody very soon to Xbox. But all right, we've been random enough in this show. Jeffrey, thanks for your time.
Happy to be here.
Chris Chawla, again, congratulations to you and everybody on the ID at Xbox team, team shipping 500 titles. Huge milestone.
Yeah, thanks a lot. And thanks to all the developers who've been supporting the program.
Yes, thank you, developers, and thank you, fans. All right, gang, we'll talk to you next time. Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye.